Those who are banking on the scenario that the human race will never find out its actual origin and history devise all kinds of clever methods to dissuade us from inquiring into this real history. A routinely used technique in their attempts to discredit the alternative history researchers is telling the people, don't even listen to those amateurs. They have no proper education, they're not experts, they don't know enough historic facts to make conclusions. Listen to the real professional experts instead. In this short documentary, I wanna show you what kind of extremely dodgy stuff is being presented to us as some sort of scientific research by the so-called experts that they're trying to foist under the disguise of expert scientists. This time the examples will be taken from the official history of the Inca Empire and the Caral Supe civilization. The experts assure us that the Incas acquired all these vast territories and expanded their mighty empire within a just shorty 90 years. 90 years of continuous war, non-stop very bloody battles. Wars have devastating effects on the economies of the countries involved. For example, Germany during the Second World War, which was, by the way, much shorter than 90 years, had to simply stop at some point all residential construction of homes simply because the population was too exhausted by the war. They had no strength to build anything, no finances, no resources, no materials. But this doesn't shake the confidence of the experts, and they continue to claim that against all odds, the Incas fought on many fronts, simultaneously winning new territories and at the same time managing to keep the already conquered ones under control. Further, the experts continue that these amazing Incas in those very 90 short years constructed a very good amount of monumental architecture, megaliths of gigantic proportions and precision that rivals our 3D printing technology. Although those very same experts claim that the Incas were rather primitive and did not have any hard tools for working with the hard varieties of stone, still they continue to maintain that somehow or other they built all these megaliths. And on the top of all this, during those very same 90 years, they constructed an extensive network of roads at places some 7 meters wide. They cross the Andes, the South American Cordillera Mountains, and reaching all the way to Santiago, nowadays Chile, the longest well-preserved segment of such a road is some 6,000 kilometers long. The total length of Inca roads is roughly estimated to be some 15,000 to 30,000 kilometers in length. A construction project of this magnitude would put a strain even on our modern budgets, especially taking into consideration the harsh mountain terrain. For example, the technology of nowadays Peru supposedly far surpasses that of the Incas. At least now we have modern vehicles with wheels, we have steel and iron tools of transportation and building, and on the top of that, the population is many times more, supposedly according to the experts, than in the times of the Inca Empire, and still the Peruvians nowadays cannot get themselves together to build a road system that covers all of their cities. Till date, many of their cities are not accessible by road and only by air. When I lived in Peru, I was in the city of Pucallpa. It's a big city, and it is still part-time connected to the capital, Lima, by road. By part-time, I mean it depends on the season. When it starts raining, they simply have to close the road. It is so poorly constructed that it doesn't function when it rains. The picture of the Inca Empire, painted by the so-called experts, seems to be radically divorced from reality. And still they continue to insist that in these 90 years, half of the male population was fighting, the other half was building, and they fail to mention even who was feeding all this, who was supplying the resources for the army and all that. Don't forget that allegedly agriculture was much more laborious and difficult in those times than it is nowadays. Even most basic common sense is not required to become an expert. For example, those experts tell us that the stones for constructing the megaliths at Ollantaytambo were quarried in a relatively nearby quarry of pink granite. That also includes, along with the pinkish-colored granite, the gray-colored one, which is also seen at the site. It is seen in the megalithic construction, but it is not seen in its so-called quarry. Well, yet another miracle. Barely anything can surprise me anymore, especially looking at the confidence with which the experts assure us that the Incas built Ollantaytambo, although in the very same chronicles that they are taking us Holy Bible, Holy Truth that cannot be questioned, in those very same chronicles there is a vivid description of how an Inca ruler tried to get together his people to transport only one of these megalithic stones, not even a big one, uphill. The full enterprise ended in disaster. The stone rolled downhill, smashing many people on its way. The reason for which they can get away with publishing such a weird stuff in the disguise of science is that they say, well, listen, we are not making all this up. We are simply trying our best to make the best sense possible of the authentic chronicles that were written by the first colonialists. Do they? Are they really trying? If they were really trying that, then how come all the originals of these writings are locked up in archives and neither the common people nor the actual historians have any access to them? Some are not available at all. Most are available in corrected editions. But what was the need of correcting them? Why are the originals hidden?
There is no lack of digital imaging technology nowadays. It would be very easy to make public digital copies of the precious original chronicles. And why their accuracy has never been questioned. For example, those very chronicles, or at least the editions that are available to us, tell us the story of how the colonialists dismantled the fort of Sacsayhuaman and built the cathedral in the nearby town with the stone from Sacsayhuaman. Strange enough, Sacsayhuaman is still standing and the cathedral is built of a different variety of stone.
В принципе, если предположить, что это был узкий скальный коридор, где можно было бочком-бочком протиснуться на вершину. Вот. А потом кусок скалы отвалился. Логичная версия, да? Если это лестница, а здесь на потолке что? Совершенно не вяжется. Во всяком случае, в нашу логику не укладывается.
It is even more confusing. How come these experts, they study for so many years, and at the end they don't notice things that even people without specialized education clearly see? Like, for example, the fact that many of the megalithic sites appear to be destroyed by something that leaves behind an aftermath very similar to that of a huge explosion. The best example are the ruins of Pumapunku and the so-called lake at Sacsayhuaman. Very large blocks are scattered around in a fashion that could not have been a result of earthquake. Earthquakes don't send stones flying 30-40 meters sideways on a even terrain, and even more so when they're scattered around in a circle. Some of the megalithic towers of Peru have also suffered a suspicious way of destruction. It is often observed that their stones are scattered around in the fields and don't lay just beside them where they would have been if the towers were destroyed by earthquake, for example. To suggest that some sort of primitive enemy of whoever the builders were destroyed the towers and then started carrying the megalithic stones around in the fields also doesn't make any sense at all. But what about Caral Supe? Here we don't have contradictory medieval chronicles to confuse the poor experts, and still we get a very weird story again. First, a town-like settlement with pyramidal structures was found some 200 kilometers away from Lima. Later on, 17 more such towns were excavated in the valley of Supe. That's why the civilization is called Caral Supe. And it is considered that altogether they functioned like a state, in other words, like a country. Now, the official history of the development of human society in South America was that some 10,000 years ago, people gradually started making ceramic vessels, and then they gradually evolved, again, this is mainstream history, into forming primitive societies and eventually states and even empire, the Inca Empire. And at the same time, they are telling us that the civilization of Caral Supe existed 5,000 years ago and it didn't have any pottery at all. And indeed, no pieces of pottery have been found anywhere in these 18 settlement towns. So what is this, some sort of an exception? How can it be the exception if this is the only civilization of this type that they're placing in this time period? And how on earth do they dare to suggest that absolutely primitive people without just eating wild fruits without any culture or any organization at all in society, all of a sudden organize a state, start building pyramids, and by the way, have a full range of all types of domesticated plants, all of the ones that are even nowadays cultivated in the region. The full set of such plants have been found at Caralsupe to suggest that all this appeared in a second out of nowhere. Where is the gradual and slow evolution that they're preaching all the time? That sounds as believable as the unbelievable stories that they are telling us about the Michigan copper mining, as seen in the previous episodes. Both are equally ridiculous. But let's get back to Corral. I think what actually happened is when they saw the pyramids and how similar they are to all the other pyramids in the world, they simply decided to throw it as much as possible back in time, amazing 5,000 years, only to make it more confusing for people who try to make the connections between all these cultures that were building very similar things all over the world. In reality, the experts have absolutely no clue how to date Corral and have no intention or desire to do so. Their main task is to maintain this facade mirage that the past is under control, the main things are figured out for sure, only small details are missing, and they will be surely filled up in future with future research. Don't you worry about that. Don't ask questions about the past. And most importantly, don't try to research it yourself. That is why it is so extremely difficult to get permission to dig at the important and interesting archaeological sites. Indeed, at the most interesting ones, it is absolutely prohibited. You can't even apply. For the others, you can apply and you get refused. But for example, for Giza, they don't even accept applications. Because the more sites and artifacts get unveiled, the clearer it becomes that the official history doesn't fit the reality. Very well preserved examples of using quipu have been found in Caral. Well, but since the residents of the Caralsupe towns disappeared after existing for a short couple of hundred years, that's what the experts assure us, and although they disappeared, quipu re-emerged in the very same form after 4,000 years with the Incas. Well, I personally don't believe it. I think that there was a definite connection between these cultures. I don't believe that this very peculiar way of storing information can be just rediscovered in the very same region after 4,000 years by chance. So, what about building pyramids? The Corral civilization disappeared, according to the experts, 4,000 years ago. And this is the Tucume pyramid in Peru, supposedly much more recent. So, the pyramids were also rediscovered by chance after 4,000 years? Although it has seen better times, and this is most definitely a pyramid made of raw mud bricks. This is how somewhat better preserved structures in the area look like. And yet another gigantic pyramid made of raw mud bricks in the same area, but the experts are not extremely interested in advertising or studying it. They quickly mention it as a tomb without any details, and then direct our attention to an old tree and tell us that this is the main attraction of the area. And only if one is very lucky, one will find information like this, that in the Laraya mountain there are cities of pyramids, some 250 of them, again made of these raw mud bricks. So the conclusion is, if we really want to know our history, we have to start from scratch. It won't help adding lost ancient civilizations to the current history. Like, for example, it has become a fashion lately to attribute almost anything to a lost ancient civilization which was wiped out by a natural disaster 12,000 years ago. How can that be true if most of the information on which this suggestion is based is again mainstream?